Laudetur Jesus Christus, praise be Jesus Christ. Welcome to the Sunday live broadcast of the Angelus from St. Peter's Square here in the Vatican. Pope Francis will soon lead us in praying the Angelus as he does every Sunday. And at the conclusion of the Angelus prayer, the Holy Father will impart his apostolic blessing on all of us. My name is Father Paul Samasumo, and I'll do my best to bring you the text and the translation of the Angelus in English. On behalf of Vatican Media, I'd like to extend special welcome to all of you joining us for this live broadcast on television or radio, wherever you are in the world. Welcome to our television viewers and radio listeners of Catholic TV, Catholic Faith Network, EWTN TV, Shalom World Television Networks, Shalom TV India, Salt and Light TV, Atmadarshan TV, Luminous Radio, Radio Maria, England. We welcome those of you joining us through our various social media channels, those of you listening to the Angelus on shortwave radio, welcome. Always remember that you will find more detailed information about the Angelus of today on our website, vaticannews.va. We are seeing now the window of the study of the Holy Father, but earlier you probably saw in the square the rainbow banner or flag in St. Peter's Square here. In Italy, the rainbow banner stands for peace. There it is. It stands and signifies peace. In some parts of the world, the rainbow banner or flag represents other things. Today, 27 March, 9 years ago, Pope Francis gave his first general audience as Pope. It was the 27th of March, 2013, here in St. Peter's Square. He dedicated the audience to a catechesis on the Passion, Death, and Resurrection of Jesus. And at the end of the catechesis, the Holy Father made an earnest appeal for peace in the Central African Republic. 2 years later, he visited the Central African Republic to encourage the end of conflict there. There is still a rebel conflict, but some relative peace has returned to the country. Today present for the Angelus of today are various representatives of Canada's native peoples who are scheduled to meet with Pope Francis this week, the delegation of 32 indigenous elders, knowledge keepers, residential school survivors, and youth will meet with Pope Francis this week. It is hoped that the encounter with Pope Francis will start to address the trauma and suffering caused by residential schools in Canada. On the 1st of April, the Pope will meet the audience. In audience, he will meet the representatives of Canada's native peoples together with Canadian bishops. And still speaking of the 27th March 2020, you recall, perhaps you still remember the television images of Pope Francis standing alone in St. Peter's Square under the rain, praying for the coronavirus to end. Today, the Vatican's Dicastery for the Promotion of Human Development has produced a video commemorating that day. You will find the video on our YouTube channel soon after the Angelus today. On our Vatican News website, vaticannews.va, you'll find the video or a link to the YouTube channel. That day of the 27th March and these images on television will remain stuck in our minds. Those of you who have watched the square, St. Peter's Square is usually packed and streaming with people, but on that day we saw only the Pope walking in the rain towards the platform to the main entrance of the Basilica. It was somewhat a shocking sight, and we watched as the Bishop of Rome prayed for the world in silence to bless the world with the Urbi et Orbi blessing. The Pope prayed before the famous images of Maria, of Mary, Salus Populus Romani, and before the crucifix on that day of the 27th March 2020. here we are today. Dear brothers and sisters, a blessed Sunday to you. Buongiorno. The Gospel of this Sunday's liturgy recounts the so-called parable of the prodigal son. It leads us to God's heart, who always forgives compassionately and tenderly. Always. God always forgives. It is us who are always tired of God's forgiveness, but God never gets tired of that. It tells us God is a Father who not only welcomes us back, but rejoices and throws a feast for his son who has returned home after squandering all his possessions. We are the son. And it is moving to think about how much the Father always loves us and waits for us. But there is also the older son in the parable, who goes into a crisis in front of his father. This can lead us also into crisis as well. In fact, this son is also within us, and we are tempted to take his side, at least his part. He had always, after all, done his duty. He had not left home, and so he is outraged on seeing his father embracing his son, who had behaved badly. He protests and says, "I have served you for so many years and never disobeyed your command. Instead, this son of yours, you go so far as to celebrate him." These words illustrate the older son's problem. He bases his relationship with his father solely on pure observance of commands, on a sense of duty. This could also be our problem with God. To lose sight that God is the Father, and to live a distant religion composed of prohibitions and duties. And the consequence of this distance is rigidity towards our neighbor, whom we no longer see as a brother or a sister. In fact, in the parable, the older son does not say, "my brother," but he says, "that son of yours," as if to say, "that's not my brother." In the end, he risks remaining outside of the house. In fact, the text says he refused to go in. Seeing this, the father goes out to plead with him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours." He tries to make him understand that for him, every child is all of his life. The ones who understand this well are parents, who are very close to feeling like God does. There is a line said by a father in a certain novel, very beautiful, which says, "When I became a father, I understood God." At this point of the parable, the father opens his heart to his older son and expresses two needs, which are not commands but essential for his heart. "It was fitting to make merry and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive." Let us see if we too have these two things the Father needs in our hearts, to make merry and rejoice. First of all, to make merry, that is to demonstrate that we are near to those who repent, or those who are on the way to repentance, or close to those who are in a crisis or are far away. Why should we do this? Because this helps to overcome the fear and the discouragement that can come from remembering one's mistakes. Those who have made mistakes often feel reproached in their own hearts. Distance, indifference, and harsh words do not help. Therefore, like the father in the parable, it is necessary to offer them warm welcome, to encourage them, go ahead. What about ourselves? Do we do this? Do we look for those who are far away? Do we want to celebrate with them? How much good an open heart, true listening, a transparent smile can do to celebrate, to make them feel, make them not feel like uncomfortable. And then, like the father, we need... The father would have just said, go to your room, go back to work. That would have been enough as forgiveness. But God had to make a feast. He made a celebration. The joy he has because the son was back. And like the father, we need to rejoice. When someone has a heart synchronized with God, he sees the repentance of a person. No matter how serious that mistake may have been, they rejoice. Do not focus on the faults. Do not point your finger at what they have done, but rejoice over the good, because another person is mine as well. There is a story. There was a pop opera about the prodigal son. In that play, coming back, the son says to the father, he says to his friend, I'm afraid that my father will not forgive me. And the friend says to him, well, send a note to your father, saying to him, I'm sorry, I would like to come home, but I'm not sure if you will welcome me. If you will welcome me, please put a handkerchief, a white handkerchief, in front of the house. And he walks towards the father's house. And when he reaches the father's house, near the father, at an angle, at a corner, he sees his father's house. And what did he see? Not one handkerchief. There were so many handkerchiefs all over the house. And the father receives us like this, with so much joy. That's what the Father does for us. May we, the Virgin, also teach us to receive God's mercy so that we may become the light for our neighbors as well. The angel of the Lord declared unto Mary.
Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus. Nunc et in hora mortis nostre. Amen.
Ecce ancilla Domini.
Fiat mihi secundum verbum.
Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum. Benedicta tu mulieribus, et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus.
Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus. Nunc et in hora mortis nostre. Amen.
Il verbo caro factum est.
Et ad vitae vino nobis.
Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum. Benedicta tu mulieribus, et benedictus tu ventris, Iesus.
Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis nostre. Amen.
Ora pro nobis, Santa Dei Gentis.
Dignificiam promissionibus Christi.
Grazie a Tua, in questo Domine, mentimus nostri si infunde, che angelo annunziante, che si fitui in incarnazione coniovium, per passione meius ad crucem, a resurrezione gloria per ducamur. Per Cristo Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Gloria a Patri, et Figlio, et Spirito Santo.
Sicut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Gloria a Patri, et Figlio, et Spirito Santo.
Sicut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Gloria a Patri, et Figlio, et Spirito Santo.
Sicut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Pro fidelium defuntis, requiem aeternam non est Domine.
Et lux
perpetua ducat eleis. Requiescat in
pace. Amen.
Sit nomen Domini benedictum.
Exaudium nunc et usquem in saeculum.
Aiuterium nostrum in nomine Domini.
Qui fecit caelum et terram.
Benedica vos, omnipotente Deus, Pater, Filius, Espíritus Sanctus. Amen.
There we are. We just received the Holy Father's blessing for this Sunday's Angelus. The Holy Father making some appeals. Brothers and sisters, it is now a month since the start of this war in Ukraine. Like every war, it is a challenge to all of us. There is need to end this war. A war where mothers and fathers are burying their children. Where the powerful decide when the poor die. War does not only devastate those who are there, but even those who are not there. One child out of two has been displaced in the country. This is provoking trauma among the innocent among us. That's what war does. It's a barbaric war and a sacrilegious war. War can never be anything that is inevitable. We need to convert. If out of this we come out the same as we were, then we will all be guilty in front of danger. May humanity come to the realization that time has come to abolish all wars. I pray for all politicians that are responsible to reflect and to do more and to look at all those who are suffering in Ukraine. And I renew my appeal, enough. May it all stop. Silence all the guns. May there be peace. Let us pray. To Mary our Mother, the Mary Immaculate, to whom we consecrated Ukraine and Russia last Friday. Thank you. Let us pray together. Holy Mary,
tu sei benedetta fra le donne e benedetto è il frutto del tuo seno, Gesù. Santa Maria, Madre di Dio, prega per noi peccatori, adesso e nell'ora della nostra morte. Amen. Saluto tutti voi.
I greet all of you, pilgrims from outside Italy and those from within Italy. Those from Mexico, Madrid, from Lyon, and various students, young people from different parts of the world, those who have come to start their formation. And he continues with various greetings of various pilgrims that are in the square of St. Peter's here.
Come pure il comitato promotore della marcia Perugia-Assisi della pace e della fraternità, venuto con una scolaresca per rinnovare l'impegno di educazione alla pace.
All those who are pilgrims coming from various places who are here promoting peace, and also greeting those who are participating in the 27th edition of the Rome Marathon. And he recognizes the various athletes who have done their part in promoting peace, and congratulates them. 2 years ago, in this St. Peter's Square, we prayed for the end of the pandemic, and today we have prayed for the end of peace. At the end of this audience, at this Angelus, there will be some booklets that will be given out in the square to commemorate 2 years ago when the Holy Father prayed for the Angelus. So these will be distributed in the square. And to all, I wish a lovely Sunday, says the Holy Father. Please do not forget to pray for me. Enjoy your lunch and arrivederci. There's the Holy Father once more renewing his appeal for peace, passionate appeal, says, the time has come for the world to put an end to all wars. There isn't any single war that is inevitable, he says. And also recalling the 2 years ago how he prayed for peace alone here in St. Peter's Square, when he gave the Orbi blessing here in St. Peter's Square. And he says that, as you can see, people are receiving booklets to commemorate that event in the square. Just a last remark, you might have seen the rainbow banner in the square there. It is symbolizing peace here in Italy. In other parts, the rainbow flag might symbolize other things. That brings us to the end of the Angelus for this fourth Sunday of Lent. My name is Father Paul Samasumo, and on behalf of Vatican Media, thank you for joining Pope Francis in praying the Angelus. And in a particular way, thank you to Catholic TV, Catholic Faith Network, EWTN TV, Shalom World Television Network, Shalom TV India, Salt and Light TV, Atmadashan TV, Luminous Radio, Radio Maria in England. Do remember to look up our website, vaticannews.va, and you'll find there also a video released for the commemoration of Pope Francis praying for the coronavirus 2 years ago. Enjoy the rest of your day. Laudetur Jesus Christus. Praise be Jesus Christ.